The Insanely Dangerous Retro Pod Show is sponsored and proud to be part of the Scene Stealers Podcast Network and their international convention agency, who have a top-class roster of fantabulously rad movie and TV stars ready to be booked now for your next Comic-Con or other kick-ass event. Do not be dangerously insane. Check them out. You will not regret. Okay, Danger Heads and Insaniacs, back to the show.
Stand by. You're live in 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Hello yet again and welcome to the Insanely Dangerous Retro Pod Show. We are the world's most fearsome fighting team. We feel the magic and hear the roar as we celebrate, venerate and ejaculate the very best of times, aka the 1980s and the 1990s. It's a real wacky show where anything goes. Each week, we leap back and forward in time, striving to put right what once went wrong, and hoping that the next leap will be the leap home. Joining me on this 50p shop calamity clusterfuck, where Paul Young lays his hat, is a stoic 1980s encyclopedia that just happens to be the inspiration for Roxette's third best song. He is the bastard love child of Arne Anderson and the ginger bloke from Mask. He's amazing. He's fantastic. Wherever there is trouble, he'll be there. Welcome to tonight's show, Dangerous Dave. Well, it would have been dangerous, but what we decided to do, just instead of having our inane banter for 5 minutes, we decided to get straight on with the show and talk to our guests, which is what everyone really wants us to do. So what we decided to press record straight away with our guest and get in there and start talking about the reason why you're here for a change. Let's go. This week we're talking about the 1992 BBC horror mockumentary Ghostwatch. On Halloween 1992, the BBC aired a one-off audience participation and investigation into suspected poltergeist activity at a family home in the London borough of Enfield. With serious journalists Mike Smith, Sarah Green and Michael Parkinson fronting the show, this seemingly live recording had a professional and trustworthy feel. The on-site crew, which also included popular presenter, actor and DJ Craig Charles, don't appear to be taking their assignment seriously, nor the story of the families whose house they're reporting from. That is, until on live TV, an entity makes itself known and the whole tone of the show changes, sending a chill down the spines of hundreds of thousands watching at home. The BBC switchboard became jammed as over 20,000 concerned viewers tried to call in. Concern quickly switched to anger, though, as it became obvious that it was all fake. The controversy caused the BBC to distance itself from Ghostwatch, and it hasn't been aired since. It has developed an internet following, and there's an anniversary DVD. Tonight, we talk to a fan of the show, of the programme, and it is Mr. Adam Gradwell of the Geeky Retro Nerd Show and of the Scene Stealers Convention Agency. Welcome to the show.
Thank you very much. Very nice intro. How are you doing, boys?
Not too shabby.
Doing well, yeah.
Good.
Why don't you tell us, because at the start of every show, we've got our little, we've got the 5 seconds saying about, you know, we're part of the Scene Stealers Network,
But for people who have, like, I don't know, like first timers or people who don't really know anything about you, why don't you tell us a little bit about yourself and what you do, and you know, and just, you know, elaborate a little bit, because all we ever see, all they ever hear me say is a scene Steelers Network at the start of the show. So yeah, tell us a little bit about yourself.
So imagine there's any amount of people out there who don't know me. So yeah, so a little while ago, I think it was 2019, I decided to start a podcast. A couple of reasons. I get frustrated when I don't be creative. I like to have a creative outlet. And when my son was really young, I didn't have that much time for stuff. So on a Monday when I had him and he would have his nap on a Monday, I thought, right, I'm going to start a podcast. And I just started, and you got 15 minutes free on Spreaker, and because I'm tight. So I thought I'd do the 15 minutes, see how it goes. I think my first episode was just me blabbing on about one of my favorite films, The Burbs. And it just sort of went from there, really. It sort of evolved into me interviewing people on the show. I think one of my first guests was Pat Sharp.
he's a great guy.
Yeah, he's really good, really funny. And then it just sort of escalated from there. One interview led to another, and then to another, and then to another. And then when I was doing that, some of the guests I was having on the show would say, "Do you know such and such, like a comic convention promoter, or do you know anybody at this convention?" And a lot of the time I would, and they would say, "Well, can you have a word? Can you speak to somebody? I would like to do this show." So I was like, "Okay," and then it sort of dawned on us, wait a minute, I should be getting paid for doing this, for setting people up for conventions. So that's how Scene Stealers came about. Me and my pal started it. Our first client was JJ Cohen, who was one of the bullies, Biff's bullies on Back to the Future.
Yeah.
And it just sort of, again, just sort of evolved from there, and it's seen Steve. I mean, I don't do the podcast anymore, actually. I do it sporadically every now and then. I think the last time I did it was a couple of months ago, because I had the opportunity to talk to Bob Gale, the writer and producer of Back to the Future. I'm a massive Back to the Future fan. So
yes.
So I got the chance to interview him. So I did that, but in the main, I don't really do the podcast anymore. The Scene Stealers is my main thing at the minute. Also, I'm part of a really brilliant, creative film production team called Life After Movies.
Oh, yes. Yeah. Oh, yeah. We know all about Life After Movies. Yeah. We've had Lisa on, of course.
Yeah. So you had Lisa on. You had Joey as well. Joey Kramer from Back to the Future. From Back to the Future. Sorry, Joey, if you're listening.
From Flight of the Navigator.
No. From Flight of the Navigator. He was a child star in Flight of the Navigator. He's one of my clients I'd seen Steelers. So yeah, part of that as well. So, you know, the two films that have already been released by Life After Movies was Life After Flash with Sam Jones. Life After the Navigator with Joey. And the next one, which I'm producer on, is Life After a Tree with Noah Hathaway. So looking forward to that coming out. And then we've got another one lined up, which I can't talk about, hasn't been revealed yet. But I'm producer on that one as well. So there's good things coming. So I'm absolutely chock-a-block with stuff.
Excellent. Excellent. That's good to know. Well, you know, make sure you keep us in the loop, you know, keep us abreast when things do happen, they develop, let us know, because we're all over Life After a Tree already. Dange and I we're sat here patiently waiting. We've spoken to Lisa about it. We're really involved. So yeah, we're dead excited. Can't wait to see that one. So is that what have you been working up to, like today, working on today? Is it anything to do with Atreyu, or is there anything that you can tell us about that you've been working on today or recently?
See, the thing is, I've always got things bubbling away in the background. I don't like to jinx them by talking about them. You know, like I say, a lot of my time, you know, I work full time as well. I'm a civil servant. And I've got two young kids. I've got an 18-year-old daughter as well. So I don't want to jinx things by talking about them, but I've got a few people lined up for scene stealers who are big names.
Nice.
Tease. You're an absolute tease. Right. Okay. All right. Well.
Well, he actually had Stan Bush as revealed as one of his clients recently.
Stan Bush. So I'm trying to get Stan to the UK. Obviously, he did a couple of songs on the Transformers the movie.
Absolutely.
Soundtrack, The Touch, and Dare.
I think that's Dangerous's favorite soundtrack ever.
Well, I introduced my son to Transformers the movie a little while ago, and he liked the soundtrack more than the actual movie.
I can imagine my daughter saying that, actually, yeah.
So when we're in the car and I'm taking him to the childminder, as he'd say, "Oh, Dad, I want to listen to Transformers."
Oh, Stan. Good lad. Yeah,
it's totally. Great soundtrack.
No, my mind was blown a little bit when Dange told me that about Stan Bush. I was like, no. Yeah, I mean, myself, it's like I had to go and see it, and I saw it. I was like, no. No, I just couldn't believe that. That is mind blown kind of stuff for retro addicts and who love movies as well. Movie soundtracks, you know, we'll go on about movie soundtracks all day if you let us.
I just love, you know, that's why I started the podcast in 2019, just to first of all see where it would go and where it would get me, because I was kind of fed up of the 9-to-5 civil servant thing. I was thinking to myself, there's got to be more out there. What is it I like doing? And I love talking about 80s movies. I love 80s movies and 90s as well. And I just, you know, I feel like I need to keep them alive, you know, and I like keeping them in the, you know, I like keeping people talking about them, and I like keeping them visible, and I want people to keep talking about them. And then, like I said before, they sort of evolved into the scene stealer stuff. And then, you know, actually talking to these people and meeting these people and managing these people as well. It's absolutely bizarre.
How did you go about, I mean, like, for anyone that wants to get into it, funnily enough, my friend's dad has interviewed a few 70s and 80s musicians. And it seems to be something that's becoming more and more common. Have you got any like tips for people who are starting? Like, how do you contact these people? I think you said your first one was Pat Sharp. Pat's a great guy. I've spoken to Pat. Haven't had it on the show yet. But he was very, very willing to have a chat with us when we had a different setup, and it just didn't end up happening. But I mean, is it just a case of going on Twitter, or, you know, do you have to know someone?
What I would say is social media is your friend.
Mm.
You know, so something, I mean, people like Pat took a chance on me because I hadn't interviewed anybody before, and he's such a great guy. You know, I didn't have anything to sort of point to and say, oh, look, I'm good at this. He has some other people I've spoken to. Shy bairns get nout, is the saying in Newcastle. If you don't ask, you don't get. Or in Scotland, they say, near cheek, near chance, which is where I am. I live in Scotland now. If you want to just reach out and talk to them, and you never know, you just never know. So, for instance, I had Paul Young
on
the podcast, and that came about just by me commenting on something. It was actually a discussion about John Candy. And I think it was Ryan Reynolds posted a video about John Candy on the anniversary of his death. I sort of commented about why was it not Paul Young's version of Every Time You Go Away at the end of Planes, Trains and Automobiles.
Yeah.
And Paul Young commented, And then out of the blue, he sent us a message on Twitter saying, so when am I coming on your podcast then? And I says, well, whenever you want, you know. So, you know, social media is your friend. You just never, never know. You throw a comment in here or, you know, if you don't ask, you don't get.
Brilliant. Well, there you go, everyone. You heard it here. Okay, from the man who knows what he's doing as well. Fantastic. Okay. Right, well, let's go on to Ghostwatch, because from what Dange tells me, you could talk about this for like 3 or 4 hours. So you've got you've got 40 minutes.
I thought you were going to say you've got 3 hours. Go.
Right. It was a little while ago, wasn't it, now? So, and that's how we like our subjects. It's a little while ago. So how old were you when this first came out?
So when did it come out? 1992. So October 92, I was 12 years old.
Okay. So trying to get, so your point of view, like watching it, how did you feel? Like, because I remember how I felt about it. So how old was I? I was 9. I think I might have been a little bit of a dark 9-year-old, because I remember thinking, like, you know, I like ghost stuff, and I want it to be as scary and as, you know, it has to make me want to, like, you know, curl up on the sofa terrified. Otherwise, it's just not good enough. I mean, I don't know how you were you into, like, ghost stories and the paranormal? Is that one of the reasons why you were watching it?
To be honest with you, I can't remember being into paranormal or ghost stuff like that, but I suppose I was the ideal age, or, you know, us lads were the ideal age at that time, 9, 10, 11, 12 years old. But I can remember it clear as day watching it and absolutely shitting my pants watching it. I was sitting with my mum watching it, I remember, and my mum was saying, it's not real, it's not real. But I was absolutely convinced that it was real. And I was thinking about it the day, and one of the things that you struggle to, you know, to the guys listening who might not have seen it or even heard of it, and to the people who might be younger than us listening, the thing that's hard to get across is the context in which we saw this program, because... let's be honest, it was miles ahead of its time. Absolutely miles ahead of its time.
Definitely. There'd
been nothing like that before. Never seen anything like this. You know, you used the word mockumentary before. I don't know how many mockumentaries were kicking about at that time. There will not have been many. It might even have been the first one. I don't know. But it's hard to convey the fact that watching this, we hadn't seen anything like that before. So in my mind, it was absolutely real. It wasn't until, like, later on, you know, when you're older, you know, I remember many years later, my pal sort of mentioned, remember Ghostwatch? Can you remember watching Ghostwatch? I was like, yeah. And then, and actually I did a podcast episode on Ghostwatch ages ago. And when I was researching about it, you know, you find out the things, like, it was on the front page of Radio Times.
Yes.
At the time, advertised as a drama. But obviously, as a kid, I wasn't sort of flicking through the Radio Times, reading the articles and what have you. But no, I remember watching it at the time and being absolutely shit scared, because it was, I mean, when you watch it back now, it's still pretty good, actually. But when you watch it back now, you're like, how did I get sucked in by this? But it was fantastic at the time. Absolutely loved it.
Yeah, I remember watching it all, thinking this is fantastic. And you had the so-called emails or telephone calls. I don't know if it would have been emails. I think there would have been emails in 92. But anyway, yeah, people contacting the show saying, oh, yeah, something just happened to me at home. This clock moved across the mantelpiece. I was like, yeah, right. Yeah, okay, whatever, of course. But I remember being, I think my whole family, yeah, I think there's the three of us in the front room watching this. I couldn't believe how scared I was. And I don't think I've been, that was the first time I think I found myself truly, truly scared until the very end. when they're like a little like a ghostly tornado hit the studio, and as soon as that happened, I think I felt cheated.
Aye, wait a minute.
Yes, hang on a second. I wanted to be scared though. That's the thing. I wasn't scared, and I was like, "Oh, how dare you, BBC? How dare you scare me?" You know, I felt cheated because I wanted ghosts to be real and I wanted to be scared. And I think there's such a sense of realism. I think you hear it and you read it wherever you're going. You find out stuff about this. You know, it was fronted by Sarah Green, Mike Smith, Michael Parkinson, Craig Charles. You know, none of them are actors. Yeah. And that, you know, that really added to it. Like, why would you have those, especially Michael Parkinson? Why would you have Parky on a drama? You know, so it really did. It really did have that. I can see why other people complained. I can see why. I reckon they just felt stupid. It's not they're like, oh no, you. I can't believe the BBC betrayed us, which is a lot of what I heard. They just felt stupid. And they wanted to complain. But so you remember the buzz around it at the time. You remember being scared. So that's good. And that's something that keeps. That's something that stays with us. But why do you reckon as adults though? People keep going back to it, keep sticking on the DVD and making their kids watch it and, you know, and like leaving all the comments and all the YouTube videos. Why do we keep going back to it, do you reckon?
I think it's just without anything else. It's well, to me anyway, it's the nostalgia thing. It's always, I loved this when I was a kid, you know, and I'll show my kids. Well, I haven't showed my 4-year-old and my 1-year-old Ghostwatch. I remember sitting with my eldest daughter 1 year watching it, and she was like, what is this? And I've made my wife sit through it before because she'd never seen it the first time round. But, you know, I just like looking back and remembering fondly those kind of things from when I was a kid. But you mentioned before there, like Mike Smith, Sarah Green, Craig Charles and Parky, you know, it was inspired casting, really. Like yes. You say, these people would never lie to us. You know, I mean, at the time, Sarah Green, Mike Smith were children's TV presenters. Mm. So watching it as kids, you know, you believe them. Sarah Green would never lie to me. Mike Smith would never lie to me. And even the phone number to ring in to tell your stories was the Going Live phone number. So I don't know how that didn't sort of set an alarm in my head. Hold on a minute. The phone numbers that go, what was it? 0181 811 8181. So that should have been a little clue. But yeah, I mean, inspired casting. I think Mike Smith only sort of got involved because he read the script given to Sarah Green. Why would Parky and Mike Smith and Sarah Green lie to us? Craig Charles would. I was trying to wrap my brains today about if I actually knew who Craig Charles was at the time. I mean, obviously, Red Dwarf was a thing at that time.
Oh, I love Red Dwarf.
I cannot remember if I watched Red Dwarf at that time. But, you know, you said at the start that he didn't take it seriously. And there's a bit that always sticks in my mind where the coppers turn up and Craig Charles is like, oh shit, he has the coppers kind of thing. pointing over his shoulder, he has the coppers. But he was like the comic relief, wasn't he? He was playing pranks and that. I think at the start he's hiding in the cupboard or something, isn't he, with a mask on?
Yes, that's exactly it. Yeah. Is he even at the also that we've had Parky introduce the show. We've had very presentable, smart looking Mike Smith saying, like this and this, I'll be here manning the phones with my team, blah, blah, blah. And then you got Craig Charles going, ooh, on the, you know. And it's like, yeah, okay, well, we know why you're here then. Yeah. Not taking it seriously. Yeah, exactly. I mean, you've got Sarah Green, but it's like, well, Sarah Green's kind of taking it somewhat seriously. So yeah, you did need, I think you needed Craig Charles in there, who, you know, he must have thought, oh, this is the role of a lifetime, right? I mean, he's the only real, he's actually an actor. I know he was a presenter and a DJ as well, but he's actually an actor. And no one twigged that, did they? No one took, oh, why is well-known comedy actor Craig Charles in this program? But there you go. And, have you ever, you know so many people. Have you actually met anyone involved in the making of the program?
Met, no. But I did speak to the guy who wrote it when I was doing my episode on it. I can't remember. Michael Vogue?
Stephen
Vogue. I reached out to him on Twitter and did have a conversation with him, but he's fed up by talking about Ghostwatch. And he couldn't be asked talking about it. But at the time, I suspected. I mean, I respect that. Fair enough, you know. It's been out for how long? Nearly 30 years. So he's probably bound to get sick talking about it.
It's like.
But then it dawned on us sort of afterwards that he might not have wanted to talk about it in case I asked him about the controversial incident with the young lads that committed suicide.
Yeah, see, now I often forget about this, and that's not the nicest thing, you know, that's not the nicest thing to say, but at the time, I don't think I heard about it at the time, and that's the problem. It didn't get stuck to, you know, my 9-year-old flypaper subconscious at the time. And it's something that I've read about and heard about over the years, and so it always seems, that's always very much at the back of my mind, one of the last things I think about. And then I read all the details, and I think, knowing what we know now, the last 10 years about mental health and mental health conditions and everything, I think, had we known that at the time, there might, the BBC may not have got as bad press as they did, and they might not have distanced themselves from Ghostwatch as they did. Lad was clearly not well.
Yeah. I mean, if anybody was not familiar with the story, I think the young lad sort of watched the show, got scared, and then he took his own life, and he left a note that said something along the lines of, if there is ghosts, then I don't want to be here. And obviously, parents really upset, blamed the BBC. Mm. But I think you're right. If we're more savvy with mental health and things like that now, they probably wouldn't have went about it. I mean, a show like Ghostwatch, you wouldn't get away. You know, we wouldn't be allowed to think that it was real now. I mean, kids are so much smarter now than when I was a little kid, you know. Plus, you've got social media. And again, I was making myself a cup of tea earlier on. I was thinking to myself, I wonder what Twitter would have been like, or Facebook would have been like, during Ghostwatch. What would people have been tweeting about? What would the comments have been? What would be trending? Mr. Pipes.
There's going to be two sides. There's going to be two warring factions. One saying that it's real, the other one saying that it's not real. And they're both there meeting on the battleground that is Twitter, throwing barbs at one another and just being absolutely hideous. You would hope that it's not. That's just how I end up seeing Twitter a lot of the time, is it's like anyone with opposing opinions or something end up getting ridiculed or whatever. But I don't know. That's the only way I can see it. I mean, do you have a theory? Do you think would it be anything like what I said, or have you got your own theory at all?
About the social media trend and things like that. I think there'd be loads of people just saying, what a load of shite. Hashtag Ghostwatch. What is Michael Parkinson doing? Hashtag idiot.
Who's the modern day version of Parky, though? Who do we have?
I don't know. It's, I mean, it's interviewer-wise, you've got people like Jonathan Ross and the Irish fella, but, you know, you'd definitely suspect them of winding you up. They're not very straight-laced.
No, not at all. Not at all. I know Parky knew how to have a laugh with his guest, but he was very, he was a serious journalist. Yeah, if Graham Norton or Jonathan Ross rocked up and tried. Mind you, having said that, Jonathan Ross does the old film review program. I can't remember what that's called now.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
And he's quite serious on that. So maybe he might be able to pull it off, actually. But, I think you haven't, on reflection on what you said, actually, yeah, I think people are a bit too savvy. You wouldn't be able to pull the wool over their eyes.
Yeah,
because immediately they would Google, they'd go online, they'd see the online version of the Radio Times.
Yeah.
And it was there billed as a drama. Yeah, that's it.
I mean, it's took me 30 years to sort of piece it all together and understand the story and, even find out that it's... based on a real event, like you mentioned at the start, whereas now you could just Google it and find it all out straight away.
Yeah. So it absolutely wouldn't have the same impact today, you don't think? Because that's something I always ask Dangerous. You know, if that wasn't made then, but it was made today instead, would it have the same impact? But you reckon it would just, it wouldn't have the same cultural impact. It would just fly under the radar.
I mean, you've got to give it some credit because it's so well written. You know, I mentioned the guy that wrote it before. What was his name again? Stephen Brook.
That's it, yeah.
You know, and I said before, so far ahead of his time. And, you know, I read that it had to be rewritten and rewritten because the production team just weren't getting what he was trying to do. Because, as mentioned before, never seen anything like that before. But got to give it credit for... being so well written, it was so interesting besides being scary, you know, the story that threaded through it about, Mr. Pipes and what was the, it was Mother Seddons or something like that, who was found dead within the cats had scratched out her eyes or something. There was all these sort of...
Oh, yeah, that's right.
And then, you know, when Sarah Green got locked in the cupboard in the dark, there was the cats meowing and everything. So it was so well written and put together, and they had all these different horror stories threaded through it. Got to give it credit for that, definitely. But I think now, if you just watched it now, you'd be like, oh, yeah, I mean, it would. You wouldn't still be talking about it in 30 years, I don't think.
No, and I'm going to have to buy the DVD because I can't find a solid, you know, full episode online anywhere. So I'll end up buying the DVD and I'll end up putting it on for my girlfriend and my daughter because they're currently up. Every Wednesday they get banished because I take over the front room for the podcast. But they're currently upstairs now watching Ghost Adventures. So they love this kind of, they love that kind of stuff. I would love to get that DVD for them. I'd love for them to see, because my girlfriend's quite a bit younger than me, so she wouldn't have seen that at all. She wouldn't have a clue about it. So I'd love for them to see that with like modern eyes and, you know, fresh eyes in 2021, as people who, you know, believe in the supernatural and love watching it. But I also I want to get their take on some of the creepier things that happen as well. And you touched on the daughter. Was that the bit where the daughter started talking in a different voice?
Yeah. So they have the sort of the ghost woman on, don't they? I can't remember what she's called. She's in the studio with Parky.
Yeah, that's it. One of the doctor.
Yeah, she's like the investigator, and she has a video, doesn't she, at the show. There's like a voice, isn't there? They hear a voice in the house, and then they try to get the girl to recreate the voice, and they put her under, don't they? And she does the voice, and then when she's awake, she can't recreate the voice again. But that's the voice that Porky does at the end when he gets possessed, isn't it?
Yeah. Oh, that upset me. You've gone from that little girl doing that voice. I still remember how my skin was like crawling on my arms. Watching
round and round the garden.
Yeah, that's unreal. But when the little girl was there, I just remember being so cheesed off when Michael Parkinson was doing it. I'll go back to it. I felt so cheated. It's like, how could you do this? You did so well. But is that? I mean, they could have left the whole of the country or anyone that didn't bother to read the Radio Times. They could have left them all fooled and left that with a very subtle, open-ended show. Yeah, and left people worrying and like scared out of their minds. But then they went with the whole, like, the studio being, you know, the studio having a malevolent presence in there, and like, everything went crazy.
It went a bit daft at the end, didn't it?
It did. Now, is that because they really wanted us to know that it was all fake? Or did Stephen Volk just kind of go like, oh, you know what? What an ending. I'm going to go for this.
Yeah, I mean, you know, people didn't even have to look at the Radio Times. It actually says right at the start of the show, this is a drama as part of the whatever series it was. I can't remember what it was, but this is a drama. So it actually sets that up right at the start. So people obviously ignored that and just started losing their shit. Thinking that Parkinson was getting possessed. But it went a bit daft at the end, didn't it, with a sort of ghostly weather inside the studio and bulbs smashing and sort of the ghost was somehow throwing its hauntedness from the haunted house into the BBC studio. Yeah,
because everyone was watching it.
Then, you know, it sort of, Parky gets possessed, starts singing Round and Round the Garden in a ghostly voice. But then the credits come on and say, written by Stephen Volk, da-di-da-di-da. So, you know, the British public are a bit daft for... For falling for it.
Always have been. And I think there's still things out there today where I think... you say that people go, no, this is a load of old rubbish, but I reckon there's still a lot of people that would fall for it.
People just like to get mad. Imagine it now. There would be hell on just because people like to get mad just for the sake of it.
Oh, like literally nothing else.
Yeah. people just like to get annoyed and angry and post it on Twitter.
Exactly.
Right, I'm going straight to Twitter.
I'm not gonna post
my outrage at this. You know, wow, is this what I'm paying my license for?
Yeah, it's like rather than stopping and thinking and going like, you know what, I believed that, and now in hindsight, I feel rather stupid for having believed it. So I'll just make sure that no one realizes I'm one of the stupid people that fell for it. No,
just delete my account.
Yeah.
Just delete my account and come off Twitter forever.
that's the way I did it.
I like the bit in the show where, you know, the girl gets, one of the lasses gets caught banging the pipes. And because she goes missing. And I think it's Parky starts saying, right, let's cut to this camera. It's the doctor. It's the paranormal investigator person, the Ghostbuster. Mm-hmm. And she starts directing the cameras and saying, down a bit, left a bit. And then you see the lassie banging the thing with a wrench or something. And then Parky's totally dismayed. He's like, oh, this is a hoax. He's like, they're totally ripping the piss out of her. Yeah, we've set up this whole investigation and it's a bloody hoax. Parky gets really mad.
I kind of remember that. I remember her banging on the pipes, But she ends up like crying or something. She ends up having like a good reason for it. Like, you know, you don't believe me. I had to make some noise.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah. Nobody believed her. So she said she felt like she had to do something to prove it. But then, you know, she obviously forgot there were several cameras set up in the house.
I tell you what, I never, ever, ever think about the family anymore. We talk about the presenters, and you know the paranormal doctor in the studio and everything, but we never really talk about the family. I don't think they don't seem to get a look in. I don't know what the mum and the daughters are doing now. Like the daughters, you know, obviously they're grown up. They've got to be in their 30s.
I'm sure I looked it up when I did my episode on that. I can't remember what I found, but I remember the mother is an actress still doing stuff. I can't remember what she's done, but she's still doing stuff. I mean, like I say, when you look back now, the acting's not terribly good.
Oh really? I don't know. Maybe I'm looking at it through children's eyes.
Well, this is it. You know, it's always different. And that's that's what I was going to say to you before when you said you were going to show your missus and the kids it. The sort of time to watch it is gone. You know, I mean, it's good to watch now, sort of. But the time to watch it was then. You know, you cannot capture that again.
No.
Just watching it through sort of naive eyes, believing everything that you were seeing. But yeah, when you watch it back now, the acting's not it's not that great.
I remember the girls being good. I remember thinking like, you know, there is absolutely no way that, you know, there's absolutely no way that this is fake. I think my dad was scared for some of that, and then he was the first one to realise that it was fake. But I just remember thinking that it can't be. They all look ridiculous. Yeah, the family look genuinely bloody terrified. But yeah, but then like, I have seen other bits and bobs. You've got like set up a camera and you can see stuff like not just like one thing like a book fly across the room. It's like a tornado. It's like something out of a scene from Twister.
Yeah.
And it's going all over the room. And I was just like, well, yeah, sure. That could be real. That could be real. Absolutely. So,
I mean, my mom spent the whole time saying to me, it's not real. It's not real, you know, it's not real. And then I remember the bit where Critic Charles goes to the park or something because I think a neighbour's cat had been killed or something. And my mum's going, it's not real. And I'm going, but the cat's been killed. And my mum's going, it's not real. And I'm saying, but the cat's been killed, mum. It's real. They wouldn't just kill a cat for the telly man.
This is my argument I'm a skeptic. I wanted to believe in ghosts for like such a long time. I think eventually I'm like, well, no, I've just not seen any proof. And that's it. But the girls are still, you know, well into it. Yes, they do exist. And like, it reminds me of like an argument we have. And I'll watch 5 minutes of Ghost Adventures, and you see that they'll get all their bits of tech out and go, see, the tech proves it. A sound is coming out of that box. So you're telling me that they couldn't arrange for a little sound to come out of a speaker? Yeah. Like, come on. But yeah, no, I know what you mean. There's just, you know, as a kid especially, you trust the BBC, you trust these faces. But then it wasn't just kids, was it? Like I said, it was adults as well. And I watched about 5-10 minutes. I couldn't handle it anymore. I had to switch off. Or something called Bite Back, which is a I want to say it's like a complaints program, I believe, and it had the producer and I think her boss taking questions from a studio audience, and some of these people were absolutely incensed, like they bought it hook, line, and sinker. They were literally livid. I can't understand the anger behind it. But then I go back to something you said. It had never been done before.
Yeah. And that's what I mean by the time to watch it is gone. You know, never seen anything like that before. And that was the sort of context around how we watched it. I mean, now anything can be explained away now with technology. Excuse me. You know, so, you know, you said before, sounds coming out the wall. Oh, well, somebody's put their phone in there. Somebody's put some sort of remote device in there. Back then, we didn't have any of that.
Yeah.
So it was, you know, it was more believable then.
Yeah.
But no, it's got a special place in my heart as Ghostwatch.
I mean, I'm guessing you have the DVD.
Actually, I don't. I don't know if you can get it.
Apparently so.
I watched it on a couple of Halloweens ago. I watched it with my wife on, it wasn't on YouTube, it was on that other video one. I can't remember what it's called. It was on there. A really crappy copy.
Okay.
But I think it was on sale in the BBC store, but I don't know. I was going to look today, but I forgot. But I don't know if you can actually buy it. I mean, you get one on eBay or something.
Yeah, I know I think it's a 20th anniversary.
Yeah. And there was a documentary as well.
Oh, wow, I didn't know that.
Yeah, there was a documentary made about it as well. I haven't seen it, but I keep meaning to try and watch it because I think that is on the BBC DVD as well.
Oh, really?
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, that's, yeah, it's I can't have are the BBC still worried though? I mean, they released the DVD and there was a documentary made about it. Are the BBC still distancing themselves from it, do you reckon, all this time later? Like I said, it was like...
I mean, it's tame now, isn't it? It's really tame now. And, you know, I think the sort of reason they were distancing themselves was because that poor laddie took his own life. I think that was a sort of... a big reason behind them distancing themselves away from it. But, I mean, now, I mean, you know, it's so tame now. And you know, like we've said a couple of times, you cannot, nobody would get fooled by that now. So I don't know if they'd still distance themselves from it now. They're probably just not asked about it now. I actually looked today actually on BritBox to see if it was on there, and it's not.
Oh, right, okay. See, I'm trying to think. Craig Charles is still around on TV. Parky's retired, I think. Park, you know, except for a few guest appearances here or there. Sarah Green disappeared for quite a few years, but she's back on TV now. Part of me is thinking, it's like, could we contact these people? Could we find out about, you know, how they? Obviously, Mike Smith sadly no longer with us.
Mike Smith died, yeah.
Yeah. But like, you know, could we not get, you know, surely people have, they're trying to get hold of them and ask, you know, for the presenter's point of view, presenter/actor, I suppose, point of view. You know,
Ghostwatch reunion.
Yeah, something like that. Surely they'd be interested in you know, discussing it, because it could have ruined them because of the backlash. It could have ruined their careers, didn't it? But they just. Everyone seemed to just wash over the fact that some of our favourite faces had, yeah, and I don't really give a monkeys, but like lied to us. It was all the BBC, not, you know, that's where the majority of the focus is on. It was the heads of BBC. How could you do this to us? But the celebrities seemed to just like walk away with not a scratch on them. They're like, yep. Okay, not a problem. Their careers didn't seem to suffer.
Yeah, no, not at all. Not at all, I don't think so. And I read earlier on, you know, obviously this was all recorded. You know, it was made out that it was live. It wasn't, it was recorded. And all the writers and production team were together as it went out. And they heard that the phone lines were jamming for people complaining. and they couldn't believe it. They were expecting a different kind of reception. They didn't think that people would fall for it. because they see anyway, they genuinely didn't set out to dupe people, because, you know, as we've already said, it was in the Radio Times. They set it up at the start that it's a drama. It's just people are stupid.
There you go. And they forgot about myself. It. Well, yeah, we're all guilty. We're all guilty of doing something stupid. It's just not all of us go out and admit it to the rest of the world. Okay. Right. Well. Yeah, we'll let you get on. Thank you for coming on. Really appreciate it. No worries. What are you up to? I mean, I know you said you can't say what you've been doing today, but can you tell us about? I know you say you don't want to jinx anything. Can you at least tell us when? Can you at least tell us when we could be expecting something exciting?
So listen, I've always got things on the go. I'm always talking to Comic-Con promoters about the people I represent. I'm always announcing appearances. I announced there was one yesterday, Keith Gillespie, who was at Northern Ireland. He's one of my clients. I signed him up to Northern Ireland Comic-Con for next year. Another two of my clients, Andy Seacom, who is Watto in Star Wars, and Caroline Bliss, who was Andy's wife, who was Miss Moneypenny in the two Timothy Dalton Bond movies. I've signed them up to Celebrity Fan Fest in Texas. So I'm always announcing appearances. I'm also semi-always announcing new clients who I'm representing. So I can't really say who I've got lined up.
Okay.
Because I kind of, you know, there's a lot of sort of work goes on behind the scenes, and a lot of them as well. I collaborate with people to represent some of these guys. And there's others as well who I represent privately to promote us, because the celebrity in question doesn't want to have a publicly named. It's complicated. It's a complicated business at times. I mean, if you want to know what I did today, I can tell you about my civil service job that I did today, which is incredibly boring. But I'll tell you what, I'll give you a little teaser. So I got an email tonight, actually, about somebody who I want to work with, and they are interested. And this person was in a very popular HBO series in America. It was shown over here as well. Super, super popular, about a young movie star and his entourage.
Okay, well, nice little teaser. Well, we shall ask no more. We'll wait and see. We'll wait to see, and I can't wait for that to hit the press.
Yeah. I mean, I do more things on Facebook than Twitter, to be honest. Facebook's where I announce me stuff. But, you know, if you have a look, I'm getting Lisa gigs as well from Life After Movies. I mentioned that at the top of the show. The Life After Movies team are going to Louisville in Kentucky next year to do a Comic-Con, where we're going to be there with Joey. Joey's going to be there as well.
Awesome.
Noah is going to be there as well, Noah Hathaway. We're going to be doing a show in Southampton next year as well, Life After Movies.
No way!
Yeah, we're going to Southampton Comic-Con. Don't ask me when it is. I can't remember, but it's next year. But Life After Movies is going to be there. And I don't know how much I can say about that, because I leave the announcements to them. It's their gig. I just sign the people up and then they do the announcements and things like that. But Life After Movies is going to be there. Hopefully in the coming months as well, I'm hoping Lisa will announce soon who the next subject is of the Life After Movies series, because it's somebody from a movie that is it's a huge movie, put it that way.
Oh man. Well, that's two amazing things, because I've only ever been to one Comic Con before, and that was in Southampton, and that was with Dange. So and Dange actually, well, he didn't have to twist my arm, but he was like, "Botch, this is on. We're doing it. Okay, then." Now, yeah, that was pretty much the conversation. But now we have to go, because now we get to see all of our friends in the flesh, as it were.
Yeah, I know. It's going to be good to get back to them, but I think they're going to be very, very different.
Yeah. So, no,
they're not going to be as touchy-feely. there's going to be, a certain level of restrictions, I would say. Mm-hmm. We'll have to wait and see how it plays out. But yeah, but no, come to Southampton next year. Lisa's going to LA as well. Fingers crossed I'll be there as well in December. But yeah, it's a Life After Movies. Lisa's going to go to LA Comic Con. Hopefully I can go as well. Life After Movies is going to be in Edinburgh as well. With Joey. I can't say that because that is announced. Joey is going to be in Edinburgh. Comic-Con Scotland in Edinburgh in October this year, and Joey is going to be at For the Love of Sci-Fi in Manchester in December.
Wow. Excellent. Well, you're really busy, all of you. So you're all, as a team, you're ridiculously busy then, by the sounds of it.
Mega busy, mega busy. That's through the night last night answering emails.
That's amazing. Well, brilliant. I'm really, really chuffed for you. Seriously, so I could spend about a quarter of an hour, because, I can talk, saying how pleased I am for you and everything, and how chuffed that we've got this connection. Rather than go on and on and everything, I'll ask you one last one. I was going to say, if you could interview anyone who's currently still with us from your childhood, but since you've got away from that a little bit and you're actually going more towards the convention, appearances side of things, if there's anyone from an 80s or 90s film that isn't currently signed up with you, that you could get to sign up, who have you got your sights on? And you're thinking, I want you. The second I see a tiny opening, I'm in there, and I want to sign you up. Or can you do that? Or is that going to be controversial?
No, that is a very hard question. So, let me start with answering the first question you were sort of indicating on. Who would I like to interview? Honestly, when I started the podcast, top of the list was Sam J. Jones, Flash Gordon.
Wow. Okay.
I got to interview him. And who was it? Oh, Bob Gale, Back to the Future.
Oh, wow. Yeah. Brilliant. Yeah.
And I got to interview him as well. So, I was really, really lucky to be able to do that. Who would I want to sign up to Scene Stealers? I have tried and failed somebody like Chevy Chase.
Wow. Okay.
I really like Chevy Chase. It's somebody I do represent on Scene Stealers, actually, who starred with Chevy Chase as Cindy Morgan from Caddyshack, and she was in Tron as well.
Yeah. I know Cindy. Well, not personally. I was going to say I know Cindy Morgan. We go way back. No, but yeah, I know who you mean. Sorry.
Yeah, and another one. I don't want to jinx it because I am in conversation with this person, but somebody who is in National Lampoon's movies.
Oh, Dange, here we go.
But not Chevy Chase.
Okay, so you don't.
There you have it.
Ah, right. So again. Another, yeah, something else in the pipeline. So we have to wait for again. Oh, there's so much.
I like season. I throw out that many lines when I go fishing. That's a crazy analogy, but yeah, I'm really enthusiastic about it. Like I said before, I love 80s movies. And the good thing about this is I kind of get to pick who I want to speak to. And, you know, I think, oh, I love that film. I'll reach out to that person and see what that's. And even, if, you know, they say no, thanks, or I'm already sorted, or thanks, but no, thanks. At least I've had a nice conversation with them and connected. So it's all good.
Wow. Okay. Well, I'm gonna have to off air. I'm gonna have to pick your brains on how you do this, because to me it seems like witchcraft. But yeah, well done. Well done. That's excellent. Great answers. Okay. Well, yeah, and you've just left us, as all the great entertainers do, wanting more. Yes. Okay. All right. Well, thank you. We really, really appreciate you taking the time to come on, talk about Ghostwatch, just giving us your insights into it. And of course, just, getting in touch with us in the first place and hooking us up with Joey and Lisa. So, yeah, really, really appreciate it, dude. Thank you so much.
No worries. Keep up the good work.
You know what that sound means? It's another episode of Game for a Movie, where we ask, are you game for a movie?
Tell me, Andre.
There's no special features on that goddamn DVD, alright?
Oh, wow.
For Hansel and Gretel one?
Hansel and Gretel.
You have the DVD of Hansel and Gretel.
She basically has sex with it, somehow. Foreplay.
Yes.
She's chair foreplay.
I mean, they knocked it out of the park, which is why it's my number three.
So. Oh!
Yes. I mean, I wouldn't be in it because this movie doesn't have women. But, you know, it's fine.
It has one.
You would have three lines of dialogue.
No, she has more than three.
Oh. Okay. So I'm actually going to get, like, I earn my four sentences of dialogue rather than, like, here, have a paycheck. You just stood there on the screen. You're a sexy lamp.
Favorite form.
Anyway, we're not.
No. Because they really hate each other, so we get to enjoy some wonderful comedic scenes of them hating each other so much that they get into physical altercations that include her biting ex-detective Phillips's dick.
Okay.
But we don't.
Okay.
In the hot tub.
I know all of those words were English, but the way you constructed them, I'm lost.
I'm not following the arrangement of them very well.
For those who haven't rated us or liked or given us a review, don't say that we haven't given you anything of value after listening to this podcast. You now know the difference between an R-rated dick and an NC-17 X-rated dick. You're welcome.
Thank you guys for listening to Game for a Movie, where we ask, are you game for a movie? We'll see you next time. Bye.
Bye.
Well, here we go. Second half. I thought that first half was great.
It was.
Yeah, apart from the distinct lack of Dangerous, because I took over again.
Well, I mean, it's about the show's about the guests when they're on, so I was just letting you guys carry on. It's not a problem.
Yeah, and we love having guests on as well, because sometimes I'm like, oh no, what's going to happen? But then we have the guests on. We're like, actually, this is fantastic. And Adam's love for and the insight into the show really showed shone through and everything. What we didn't go into too much detail with was the was the negativity surrounding the show. And we did a little bit, didn't we? Yeah, we touched on it, but I think, you know, most of the time it's kind of like, keep it light and don't talk about, you know, sensitive, you know, uber negative things. But I think, yeah, we want to pick up on that a little bit because I don't want to totally forget about it. And I don't think Adam said that he remembered any of the criticism at the time.
Yeah.
I mean, do you remember the criticism at the time, or is it all was it all years later that you know about it?
I mean, I didn't remember at the time. I mean, like you both, I was watching it on Halloween night, you know, glued to it with my parents saying, oh, it's not real, blah, blah, blah. So, I don't think I paid too much attention to the news or newspapers. If I did, it just kind of glossed over it. So I don't really know too much. And I mean, it wasn't until, like you say, years later that you knew about it and heard about it. But I was just kind of like, I think when we revisited a few weeks ago, it was when I more delved into what had gone on with it. But yeah, I wasn't aware of it at the time.
Yes, it seems odd considering the fuss that there was that we didn't hear about it. I would have thought that we would have heard even just a little bit about it, but none of what I read from, you know, when I did this a couple of weeks ago, or when I researched it a couple of weeks ago, none of it rung a bell. None of it, you know, made me think, oh, crikey, yeah, okay, yeah, I've got that. And I know I was only nine. And, you know, obviously, when you think about this show, you think about being scared, thrilled that you're watching something so, like I said, I think I was a bit of a dark child. But, like, you know, I wanted to be scared. It's like, you know, I wanted it to be real so badly. But then, you know, like I said, utterly betrayed. It's like, oh, for fuck's sake, BBC, what's this whirlwind bullshit?
I don't think I ever remember thinking that at the time. I mean, looking at it now, it was just kind of like a more of a film type finish. But at the time, I don't think I was thinking that at all.
Oh, you marked out, did you, big time?
Yeah, I probably did.
Oh, I think that's good.
This is the show that got me into the paranormal, to be honest. So,
oh, really?
I think so. From what I remember, I mean, it took ages until like Most Haunted came on. But I mean, obviously, like you say, people don't believe it. People do believe it. It's just the way it is. So, but I think this is what kind of got me interested in it. But yeah, obviously, knowing it now that it was just meant to be a film in that sense, a drama. So, I mean, I remember watching it, thinking, you know, Sarah Green in there is just like, I don't know. It wasn't like she wasn't taking it seriously, but she was kind of like just there having a good time, you know, nothing really happening. It wasn't until a certain point in the evening where something happened and she was a bit concerned about what was going on in the film or at the time. Yeah. But I just remember thinking, oh, this is quite a, you know, it's well paced out in terms of, like, you know, nothing really happens for a good, what, half an hour maybe?
Oh, yeah, it's a little while, isn't it? Yeah, sure.
So I mean, they definitely set the pace pretty well in the show.
Definitely. So. Yeah, absolutely, dude. Yeah, and yeah, you make two really good points I want to touch on there. One is the pacing, which I think is absolutely crucial to any sort of entertainment. You can't have a story develop too quickly, because otherwise it will peter out and you won't give a toss about it. You can't have it go on too long. You need to have it be a drip feed. You need to be drip fed a story over the whole you know, span of whatever it is that you're watching, so you really feel as though you've gone on a journey. So yeah, it was well paced. But also said Sarah Green seemed like she was quite happy about it and everything's fine. And that, yeah. And as kids, that's what we're used to on going live, isn't it?
Yes. Yeah.
We're used to that. So to see Sarah Green troubled and then she goes past troubled onto being scared.
Yeah.
Well that sends a little chill down your tiny child-sized spine, because you think, you know, here's the phase of happy Saturday mornings, scared at, yeah, and she's a grown-up, let's not forget, because when you're a kid, grown-ups are invincible, and then you see Sarah Green, especially a celebrity, they're invincible, nothing can stop them, and yeah, and so that was actually, our lovely Sarah Green has gone on to a grown-ups program. And now she's scared out of her mind. It's like, oh, is she out of her depth? Oh no, what's going on? Yeah, that was kind of eerie. And it had me on tenterhooks. Like I bought into it because I use this word all the time. I think it's one of my favorite words: gritty, gritty realism. At least that's what you thought at the time. Obviously, it's not aged brilliantly, but then they've gone overboard, and it's. Yeah, they did spoil it a little bit, but if they found a more subtle, perhaps speculative or vague ending, followed by the declaration that it had all been entertainment, then I don't think, I think I probably would still love this even more.
Yeah.
I think I'd love it even more than I do now. I think I'd be screaming for Stephen Volk to do more.
Yeah.
Yeah, and to be way more loved and respected than he currently is.
Yes.
But as it is, I'm a bit like, that ending's always going to ruin it for me, no matter how well paced, thought out, acted, everything until... Maybe the last. I don't know how long it was. Maybe is it the last 10 minutes? I can't remember.
10 minutes? About 10, 15 minutes, I'd say.
Are you quite like the idea? Because they lose touch with the house. Do you remember? Am I remembering that right?
Yeah.
And Mike Green, considering he's not an actor, Mike Green actually had me a little bit worried at one point.
Yes.
And he says, like, I'm not going in. Like, he stops being this presenter.
Yeah.
What he does, he stops being a presenter, he stops worrying about his job, and he starts being a husband. And he goes, look, I'm not going anywhere until I know what's happened to my wife. And I was like, and it's that as a child, it's seeing that grown-up lose, the grown-up's reactions, grown-ups are losing their shit. what's going to happen next? If grown-ups are losing their shit, it must be bad.
Yeah.
That was fantastic. God bless him. Well done, dude. It's a real shame that it hasn't been seen by more people, I think, even with that ending, because there were some pretty amazing bits of it.
Yeah, and I mean, I did see that you can actually get it on Amazon for $7.99 now. So.
Oh, there you go. See?
You can get it on eBay as well, so...
Ah, there you go. See, now I did the man a favour. I did him a solid, didn't I?
You did. You did.
Yeah, there you go. See, he's done something. Yeah. He put us in touch with Joey Kramer, and I told him about a DVD. So there you go.
We're all even now.
That's it. Symbiotic relationship. Lovely. Yeah. But let's talk about the fallout again, though. Sorry. Now, even though I was disappointed, and like there is that disappointment is still there now as an adult, almost 30 years later, I don't think I ever felt the need to find someone to complain to about it. I've written letters in to people and places and everything when I wanted to have my say, because that's just the kind of child I was. But I never felt like I needed, I didn't write into points of view and going, this is terrible. I don't know what's happened to Trevor and Simon recently, but they really need to buck their ideas up. I don't mean like that or anything. I just mean, I don't know, tiny, silly little things. But I never felt the need to actually write in and properly complain and to let the whole country know that I was stupid enough to be taken in. The whole like you lied to us, and
you
say, yeah, is it even though it was billed as a drama, so you used real presenters,
Michael Parkinson, for God's sake,
yeah,
flipping Michael Parkinson.
It was very much like, oh, you build it as a drama, but I forgot and I feel stupid, and now it's your fault. I want someone to blame, but like, it is proper, like, you know, I'll go back to that Adam Hill's thing, saying, hey, can we all stop being dicks? If you complain to the BBC, or is it Ofcom? Yeah, Ofcom about this thing, you are a Rizzler paper away from being a cancel culture douchebag. As I said, yeah. Adam was saying that this show would get cancelled today. I mean, I don't know if that was... I think it's a valid point, do you not think? Like I know how you feel about...
I mean, I don't know if it would, to be honest, because I mean, you've got shows like Most Haunted, and as you say, like, they're massive in America with the Ghost Adventures and all sorts of other shows that are on as well. So, I mean, I think that people would probably be a bit more wary in terms of that. They'd actually pay attention to it not being a real thing if they watched that it was a drama.
Okay.
That's just my opinion. I think, you know, people will watch it if they like this sort of thing. But I don't think, you know, I'm sure there'll be people on there who will watch it and do what, you know, Adam said in terms of, like, you know, what's this all about? Why are we watching this? Blah, blah, blah. What a load of rubbish. But I think because everything's so researched these days and everything's looked into more, I think they'll be a bit smarter in terms of knowing that it's not a real show in terms of, but I mean, yeah, it's possible it could happen the way you said, but I think the internet has taken that away as well, whereas a lot of this was now just like Radio Times back in 92 saying it was a drama, and it said at the beginning, even the link I watched of this show where the BBC guy who's introducing it says, you know, here's a drama Ghostwatch or whatever. So I just think that it would be, I think it would be okay in terms of as a film today, because it's become bigger in terms of that kind of genre. Okay. I think
that's good. It's good to have like a couple of different opinions on it. I mean, you I think we got, I mean, I'd say I'm in between. Like, I can see both things happening. Like, I can see someone saying that you need to, because of the current climate we're in, you can quite easily see it being called to cancel and almost being cancelled. But then at the same time, I can also see a lot of people saying the opposite and just saying that it's just it's a badly acted piece of shit or something. So it's funny. I can see both, but. Yeah, it's very interesting that it did cause so much fuss. But I mean, again, I know I've spoken to you about this. I don't know if you actually watched it yourself. I brought it up when we were talking to Adam.
I didn't see any of the actual controversy in the comments and that.
I watched that BBC complaints program, Bite Back.
Right.
And it is a Karen-filled audience of crimes against fashion. Crybabies,
right? Okay.
It's terrible.
And it's about Ghostwatch, right?
Yeah, this particular episode. Yeah, Bite Back was a weekly thing where they, people with nothing better to do would come in and go, "Well, I've got this to say," thinking they're hilarious and being, you know, being bellends. No, yeah. Sorry, son, I can't come and see your school play because I've got to go in and complain about something no one cares about. there's this one guy. Oh, he looked like Peter Stringfellow's younger brother who's trying to be a wedding DJ or something. he said... I immediately went, fuck off, paused it. And made this note, because he said, I'm paraphrasing, but it's quite close to what he said. My 10-year-old threw up.
Right.
Watching that program. And I was just like, he said something else a little bit more, but that was pretty much it. My 10-year-old threw up because he was so scared from watching that program.
Okay.
Straight away, I want to say, fuck off, you liar. No, he didn't. I was 9,
yeah,
and I was hardly, I mean, I might have been a bit dark and a bit into like ghosts and stuff. Like I had like a million books about haunted houses, haunted pubs, castles, adventure books. We had to like roll the dice. It's like, oh dear, ghost has scared you to death. Never mind. You know, I loved all that stuff. But it was hardly a steely, nerved child.
No.
I wasn't the bravest kid in the world. You know, like walking in a strange place when it's dark. I used to hate that. But, you know, despite that, I wasn't about to fucking throw up out of fear. That's crazy. Producer Ruth Baumgarten made an excellent point, and she said in response to a complaint that should the BBC never make a program about anything unsettling ever again.
Yeah,
I thought, oh, that's an excellent point, to which the whole audience just went, oh, look at that, complete fucking silence. And then all of a sudden, I think everyone who had said nothing had realised that they'd said nothing, and then just started like going, bah! And they can generally like, House of Commons, unsatisfied, kind of noises. And to be fair, I'm not saying they've never made an unsettling programme since. I mean, one that just springs to mind, I haven't even made notes about this. I think I want to say it's the first episode of Spooks.
Yeah.
I think it's the first episode. Oh, my throat's going. I said at the start of the interview to Adam, my throat might go. I think it's the first episode ever of Spooks, and it had the actress Claire Goose.
Yeah.
And she was very, very popular. Yeah. Very, very popular. Obviously, in Casualty, I think it's Casualty or Holby City. Very, very attractive. And I think everyone thought there's some great things ahead for her. And now she's in this brand new program. And straight away, at the end of the episode, this nasty piece of work grabs her by the head, yeah, dunks her head in a chip in a deep fat fryer.
Right.
And deep fries her face off.
Wow.
And then lets go of her hair and she falls to the floor and she's dead. Now that's pretty fucking unsettling. I'm pretty sure that was the first episode. So immediately you're watching that and I was like, holy shit. So I think like both my mum and I looked at each other and was like, what the fuck just happened there? And because you know, you weren't expecting it, especially to Claire Goose. Like, what the hell? So you know, they it's not like they this program didn't ever put them off doing, you know, pushing the boundaries.
It did not.
They still pushed the boundaries.
I think when did Spooks come out though? Was it 2000s or was it late 99s?
I think it was late 90s, but I don't know. But it is a considerable time later. Yeah. So again, I think there's some sensible decisions made by the BBC. Sadly, a young man lost his life, or took his own life.
Yeah.
As a result, or partly to do with, you know, this program.
Yeah.
So they did distance themselves, but smartly they rode the wave of the of the badly dressed Karens, and they, you know, and they went, fuck it, yeah, we'll carry on pushing the boundaries and doing crazy shit because we don't want to make beige margarine programs. So I want to say, like, well done, BBC. Really, I was like, really, I'm impressed by that, actually. They pretty much, they stood in front, well, they sat there in front of this audience.
Yeah,
and just pretty much said, look, we didn't realize we were going to get this response, but in the nicest way, calm the fuck down. Brilliant. I absolutely loved it. Absolutely loved it. Yeah, so good old BBC. They didn't need to say sorry. Not unless it was followed by that you're a dumbass pussy. Because they should have definitely said that. Yeah, I'm sorry. Sorry, you're a dick. I wouldn't have been able to hold my tongue. So yeah, they did a good job there. But also, Sarah Green, in my mind at the time, she was like my favorite English childhood crush.
Okay.
That is until years. I was convinced that Kim Cattrall was American, but she's actually, what is she? English Canadian?
From Liverpool, I think. She was born. Yeah.
There you go. So, crush one, crush two. But yeah, absolutely love Sarah Green. Real bundle of fun. I'd still see her in my mind's eye going 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. And with the game that they did on Going Live. Yeah, real bundle of fun. Real just. She was one of the cool adults, the cool grown-ups. Yeah. And I think that's a real, it's a great casting move there because they've got both ends of the spectrum.
Yeah.
They've got Sarah Green. So all of a sudden, there's a part of me, I swear, my mum was reading the paper because this is what we all used to do, wasn't it? Rather than looking at the guide on the TV and go, yeah, that'll do. We used to read the paper.
We did.
Yeah, and like part of me misses that. So you read the paper and you go, you run your finger down the paper so you get a little grey fingertip. Yeah. Oh, look, and I'm pretty sure my mum brought my finger down. I said, oh, and turning to me, so Sarah Green's in this. So, yeah. You know, and it's a program about ghosts. So immediately I was sold. why did so many of us choose to tune into it? I know that's why I wanted to watch it. Sarah Green and ghosts, don't care what it's about other than that. Why did everyone else watch it? Do you remember why? Was it you? Was it your parents?
I think I was just interested in the paranormal, so I just kind of like managed to talk my folks into letting me watch it. But you know, I don't remember the exact thing that happened when I was sat there watching it. But I mean, I think I was a bit scared and all that sort of thing. But
but it was you that convinced your parents to watch it then.
I think so, yeah. I do remember watching it, and I do remember my mum just going, oh, you know, like yours and Adam's is going, oh, it's not real. I don't think it scarred me for a long time, but I just, you know, I didn't sleep that well nights after that. But eventually I just kind of let it go and forgot about it. But I don't really know what I mean, I remember watching Ghostbusters as a really small kid, so I was always interested in Ghostbusters and that sort of thing. So I thought, well, maybe this is going to be like that, you know, Ghostwatch, you know. So I can't remember the exact day of, like, I know it was October the 31st, but I don't remember if it was a Friday or if it was a weekend back in 92. So I don't think it was a school night. So
no, I want to say it was a Saturday or something.
Yeah. So I think that made it a bit easier to watch it as well. You know, because, you know, as a kid, you're always allowed an extra day of staying up later on a weekend or a Friday night. So I think that helps weigh it. But I don't think I was too popular afterwards. But I really don't remember exactly what caused me, what other than my interest in ghosts.
So it's weird that, because I'm thinking like 9 times out of 10, difficult one. Let's just say for the sake of argument, 9 times out of 10 that my dad was in quotation marks, in charge of the TV, of what we watched. So I'm just trying to wrap my head around why the fucking hell would he want to watch it? But maybe he thought, okay, Michael, maybe the adult in him thought Michael Parkinson.
Yeah.
Like it could be, because his viewing habits, I don't think they've changed in the last 10 years. I think it's pretty much like Morse and Poirot.
Okay.
And that's it. I don't think he watches any other TV apart from Morse and Poirot. Okay. And so I can imagine him going like, well, it seems it's a documentary about, you know, it's an investigation.
A live investigation
hosted by Michael Parkinson. Was that something done by the BBC? They got a presenter to you know, for all ages.
Possible.
You know, like Craig Charles.
Craig Charles, Dave Lister from Red Dwarf. I mean, I remember watching Red Dwarf at the time. So I think that was maybe another reason why I wanted to watch it. But, I mean, obviously Sarah Green in it, going live. I did just check on Google and see that it was a Saturday. So, I mean, again, you know, back then I was able to watch Match of the Day. So, you know.
You're not anymore.
No, I don't watch Match of the Day now. But,
well, you're not allowed to watch it anymore.
I'm not allowed to watch it anymore now. Got banned after after Leicester won the title and Lineker presented in his pants. But, So I think that was one of the reasons. It was a Saturday night, so and we never used to do Halloween trick or treating or anything like that. So I think we just stayed in and watched it. So
yeah, I guess back in the day as well. I think it's easy to forget as well that. This being 1992, there is absolutely bugger all else to do apart from like play cards, read a book, play a family board game.
Well, yeah, you had the Mega Drive and the Super Nintendo, I guess.
Well, yeah, but I mean, like for the adults,
for a family, yeah.
Yeah, for a family, you know, with two adults, you know, there wasn't a lot. There wasn't a lot. I mean, but then I think that made for better programming. I think perhaps, you know, they tried to put a whole load of shit out there.
Well, you all know me and my Saturday night TV entertainment. Oh, so, you know,
yes, yeah.
I did love a bit of 80s and 90s Saturday night TV. So.
Oh, God, don't you? Yeah, we've had that conversation about 1,000 times. No, not in a bad way. No.
It was just better.
You know, it was rubbish. No, had that conversation a million times where you've just been, you know, you've even written down your schedule for me. Yeah, you're like, yeah, there we go. This is it from 4 o'clock in the afternoon up until bedtime. No, but it really was. I could stomach family TV when I was a kid. Yeah. I think now I know there's more out there. I just don't think I can sit down and watch family TV, you know, the Generation Game and Noel's House Party and whatever else, you know, over and over. I can't do that anymore. Now I know there are people out there that want to make like Ghostwatch, you know. I was trying to think of something else. Might as well go with the show.
Gladiators.
Yeah, but like I wasn't even a fan of Gladiator. I think I like Gladiators more now, actually, funnily
Baywatch.
Enough. Yeah. Well, I was gonna say that's the thing. If there's stuff out there like Ghostwatch, and oh, you know, that's just like in 92. But I mean, like, modern, if there's things out there like gritty dramas and documentaries and stuff, and why the hell am I watching some irritating housewife from Slough trying to make a vase or something? Like, what the fuck am I doing with my life?
What, from the generation?
No, you, yeah, no, you dumb bitch. It's step, step back, step, step forward. Cha, cha, cha. Bloody hell. What are you tripping over? What's wrong with you? Yeah, no, I just, I can't do that anymore, man. I can't watch it. And I don't know if it was Ghostwatch that started me off feeling like that. Okay. But maybe it's so
disease. Saturday Night TV for you.
Yeah, maybe it showed me that there was a world beyond, you know, well beyond Bruce. You know, like the
entertainment.
Yeah, like I think I probably still watched it for another 3 years or something, and I probably enjoyed it. But if there's a chance for me to watch Hellraiser or something, you know, Hellraiser's on BBC Two, or it's won't be the generation game, would it? Let's say Noel's House Park. Oh no, whatever. On at the same time on BBC One, while I'm watching Hellraiser, and it's not necessarily because it's a horror. I was just thinking of something. If it was a program about spies or I don't know, absolutely anything, something reasonably hard hitting. I think that paved the way for a lot of people's viewing habits.
Okay.
I mean, that's just one person's opinion. I think it's a fairly good one. I think it's because it was so new, because it was so revolutionary. It's what we like to say, isn't it, about a lot of things that we cover. Oh, it was so new. No one had ever seen anything like it. Yeah. That's why we're making the episode about it, because it was so fresh and so new, and people had never seen anything like it, and it changed people's attitudes, you know, and their viewing habits and everything. You know, these things that you get, like maybe on like the arse end of BBC Two,
yeah,
when, you know, regular good folk had gone to bed or whatever, things that my mum and dad didn't want to watch, I'd have to go upstairs and watch it on my tiny little TV,
yeah,
at the end of my bed. You know, it's just things like that. I think programs like, you know, what was the last one we spoke about? Fantasy football league.
Yeah.
You know, Ghostwatch. These things made you go, oh, you know what? There is more to life than old Pammy's boobies bouncing up and down in that little red swimsuit that she's got on, or yeah, or how many times is Bruce Forsyth going to do a bit of tap dancing? this is something else, and I know it's. Family TV is still ridiculously popular, isn't it? I'm not sure it'll ever completely die. I mean, surely
it's
you
not
must
as good as it used to be.
No, I mean, I think there's the only one that's really out there that's really of the, you know, in a similar vein to, you know, the stuff that you used to love is Ant and Dec's Saturday Night Takeaway.
Yeah,
I don't watch a lot of that. There's only so much that I'm like, I think like 10 minutes and I'm like, yeah, I'm done. I'm done. I need to watch something with tits and swords. I don't know. Like Game of Thrones, I hadn't even thought of that. I just wanted tits and swords. I can't watch too much of that. But that you like that, don't you? That's you want more of that on Saturday night, don't you?
Just more of the variety of entertainment in terms of. I'm okay for a drama. But I mean, I think all they make now is just dramas and dramas and dramas. And it's like, ugh, let's just have a bit of lighthearted entertainment on a Saturday night. You know, X Factor was okay for a bit, but then that just got old and boring. And then I don't know, you know, I don't think, like you said before, you can go back to what we used to have on, because I don't think there's that type of entertainer around anymore. Like, in terms of having like a Bruce or a Noel or a, you know, even Jim Davison doing Big Break or something like that. I don't think there's that many, you know, worth, you know, entertaining people out there who can do those types of shows anymore. But
and you mentioned there's not the variety. Now we go, is it Ground Force? Right. So you'd have a gardening show, a DIY show, a game show, a chat show, a drama. You had all of those.
Yeah.
You had all of those, and it was a variety throughout the evening. Now, I don't watch that anymore. I could, as far as I'm aware, they don't do that. It is singing, 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 dancing, dancing, dancing. Maybe yeah. some singing. Then a chat show, then something else. I don't know there.
Then a movie.
Oh, and a movie. You know what? I quite liked a movie on a Saturday.
Oh, yeah.
That was nice, actually, wasn't it?
It was when it was a decent movie, but...
Not
some of them. These. I mean, most of them we've seen anyway, most 16 times, because they've been on, like, you got them on DVD or whatever, but... I don't know. Just like, this is something about the 80s and 90s that were just better, in my opinion, but... It's my opinion.
So, like, yeah, I mean, that's fair enough. I can't remember what came on before and after Ghostwatch on the evening, that particular evening. But obviously, that's a massive change from the norm, isn't it? They really mixed up their BBC One Saturday night schedule for this one-off program. But you love Ghostwatch, you know. You credit it with, even though you were slightly into your paranormal stuff, this really like boosted your enthusiasm for it. Considering that, I mean, I might be wrong, but I think it really did start changing people's opinions and what they want to watch. Apart from the Karens, who are like, you know, going on Bite Back, they can fucking do one. But I think it changed a lot of people's ideas about what TV could be. So, but unfortunately, that's pushing away from what you like. I don't think they ever. I couldn't go back to how it was. Even if they did have the variety of entertainers that they used to have nowadays, I couldn't go back to that. But I mean, if it was some hard hitting TV in the vein of Ghostwatch, or it was 18 Baywatch, You Bet, Generation Game, and a movie, like, which one would you go for? That's right. We asked the hard-hitting questions. That's right. Adam did that. So I said, oh, question. I was like, yeah, that's right. It's what I do.
So which one would I go for out of the BBC and ITV?
No. Which one would you go for? Light and fluffy Saturday night in?
Oh, okay. Yeah.
Or would you go for, and eschewing Ghostwatch, you know, completely? Or would you go, no, we need to have programs like Ghostwatch out there, even if it meant, well, what's happened now, which is ruining your Saturday afternoon, Saturday evening.
Well, I mean, to be honest, Ghostwatch didn't ruin it for me, so it's a tricky one. I mean, so if it meant that I watched the Light and Fluffy, then that would stay on forever, then I would probably choose that.
But
just to let you know that before and after Ghostwatch, it had Casualty was on, and then the news, and then it was Match of the Day on at 11. So,
there you go, Casualty. So, well, that sounds, honestly, because Casualty could be not brutal, but it wasn't lighthearted, was it?
No, it was not.
And of course, the news is freaking depressing, and my dad is always bloody miserable after watching Match of the Day, because invariably Southampton would lose. So that did not make for a good evening. There's a dark cloud hanging over our house that day. Just going to Casualty, like, you'd watch an episode and like someone would be like, I don't know, playing snooker, and then they slipped and the cue snapped and it would go in their ear or something. You know what I mean? It's like, my God. Like, it wasn't as, you know, some of these injuries were pretty severe. And you're like, that's fucking minging.
yeah.
Like there's one, there's woman playing badminton. No, it was the badminton. It was maybe like squash or something, and she tripped and her racket shattered as it hit the wall.
Yeah.
But as her arm hit the floor, it came back and went towards her neck, and she stabbed herself in the neck.
Oh wow.
Blood went up the wall, and people, they were screaming or whatever. It was a horrific injury to see. They didn't try and hide it or anything. It looked, you saw this prop go into this woman's neck. It was excellently done. And I was just like, I remember wincing and like thinking like, bloody hell, that's bad. And immediately my mum popped up and went, oh, that's a pain in the neck. So that's what I always think of when people think of casualty. I can hear the sound tune, but in one ear or one part of my head, and the other I can hear my mum with a terrible dad joke. Good. Right. Well, I guess, you know, if we're moving on to casualty and Noel's house party, I think we've probably talked ourselves out.
We have.
Okay. Well. I do believe that's us for another week.
It is.
Okay, pod fans, due to time constraints and there being absolutely fuck all info to construct a quiz from this week, we're going to take our leave and give Mr. Dangerous the week off. Thanks again to our guests and our guest Adam. And don't forget to check out the old episodes of the Geeky Retro Nerd Show. And what he currently has to offer at Scene Stealers, and that's on Facebook. So go check him out. Absolutely incredible stuff. If you're into your events and meeting people from all your favorite films and TV shows, and everything else, all the other pies that he has fingers in, it's tremendous. He's an absolute hero of mine. But right, Dange, are you off to bed? Do you need a good night's kip for any particular reason?
Oh well, I've got a meeting in the morning to talk about potential Ghostwatch sequel and potential Godzilla sequel.
Oh wow, Ghostzilla! That'd be good if you combine them.
Exactly.
Wow. Okay, that's amazing. That's the follow-up. We're going to do another investigation into a haunted house
that is occupied by Godzilla.
I was going to say, oh, we could do a Godzilla reboot, but I'm a little bit, I'm about 5 years behind the times there, aren't I?
Yeah, we are a bit. Yeah. So that's why we've combined the two.
Yeah, wow.
See what comes of it. See what the BBC, see how many complaints the BBC can get from this one.
Yeah. Oh, wow. Okay. So, and of course, doing the theme tune would be Jamiroquai.
Yes. I was going to say. Jamiroquai would be doing the theme tune, yes.
Yeah. Brilliant. Okay, dude. Well, I'll let you get to sleep then, because I want to see this shit happen.
So do I. Appreciate it.
Right, but for now, Insaniacs and Danger Heads, it is good night from me.
It's good night from him.
It's good night from producer buddy.
And it's good night from Joey.
See you later, now, Gators.
And hey.
Let's be careful out here.